Good evening. The school board meeting of Tuesday, January 18th, 1994, is now called to order. First item on the agenda is adjustments to agenda. Are there any adjustments? Okay, the next item is approval of school board.
Rosemary had a hand up.
Oh, sorry.
I would just like permission to speak on item 7A and read some correspondence.
Yep.
From a member of the public. Which is where.
The next item is approval of school board minutes from the meeting of December 14th, 1993. Any corrections or changes? The minutes stand approved.
In order to organize this.
The next item is comments by high school and middle school representatives, and there are none here tonight, and it was a snow day today, so extenuating circumstances. But Matt Wright did call me this evening, and he asked me to pass along the following. The project committee is working on the senior service project. The spirit committee is working on a substitute for March Madness, and they distributed a poll to the high school students to see what they might be interested in doing. In music, five students made the all-state, what is it? It's not a team, is it a band?
No, they each compete in music festival.
Oh, okay, the all-state.
In different categories. We had five representatives who were selected.
That's great. That must be high for
a school.
Certainly think so, yeah.
In French five, they're working on a play, and in the drama department, they're working on the one-act festival and the spring musical, and the musical is still a secret.
I'll bet you
asked me to pass on.
I've heard rumors, but it's not a secret.
No, he said nobody can let it out.
Also, Rick, could you explain to us what's happening with the midterm?
Yes, I will. We had, first of all, we had over 100 calls today at the high school asking about that. What we simply did, we felt that kids and also faculty in preparation for exams, rather than skip today's schedule and go with a regular Wednesday, we just moved everything back. So tomorrow will begin exam week, exams 1 and 5, and it will carry over. I talked with Connie earlier this morning, and then we would just Monday extend that. So it will go over the 4 days, but tomorrow will be exam 1 and 5. Well, you know, I called Channel 6, and she said that that type of I probably should have been pursued the other stations. But
it was
they,
on radio.
Yeah, it was on
okay,
the radio.
Yeah.
So obviously, you can't get everybody, but you might
say. Okay.
Some
phone calls. Yeah. But Randy and I answered the phone most of the morning and then left it on the answering machine, so if anyone who called would have been able to find that out. But that's a great suggestion for the next time.
Yes.
Hopefully not this year.
Hopefully it won't happen.
No. We did get some calls from people that didn't have power even, so they had no way of getting any information.
Okay. The next item is communications.
Well, I included in your packet a kind of a potpourri of things that are not official communications, but just things that I happen to have come across that I thought might be of some interest, and we don't need to discuss them. Simply talking related to my favorite was cartoon. I like the super we
going in the guy's ear. Yeah, that's true.
Just in case this is, I realize even though this isn't in the council chambers, it is being televised as part of the referendum project. We are talking about how we want to wire buildings. This is, of course, the age of the information superhighway, and I happen to come across a cartoon that was sort of trying to get us to think about things like programming your toaster from your car and answering the phone on your microwave and suggesting a number of interesting channels, including the Pasta Network and the Lentil Channel, which might or might not be worth it. But anyway, I thought everybody needs a little humor. So, but the other articles are not quite so funny. I thought of some interest. I did, the David Broder column, I did include that because I, we haven't formally gone back to discuss the Coalition of Essential Schools. Remembering that a year ago, we left that as a future item, not something that we had shut the door on, although I think some people in the community have given me the impression they think that's a decision that was made. I think these issues about discussing and looking at where can we get help? What are the national trends? And I don't mean trend in a trendy sense, but the issues that are being discussed nationally. And I did think it was interesting that when Walter Annenberg left or gave a $500 million grant, that a major outfit receiving that is the Coalition, and not only that, but if you note where the nucleus of the administration for that grant is at Brown University, which of course is where Sizer is, actually that's kind of the heart of the Coalition. So I mean, I think there's some credibility to that whole issue that we need to keep in mind. Al Shanker's comment on school rules I thought was of some interest, and the fact that we've taken some look at that, and was talking about beginning in kindergarten and continuing all the way through grade 12. School is one of the chief places where youngsters learn about rules and responsibilities. I thought his comments were sort of commonsensical and made some points that I agreed with. And then I also thought that we sometimes are in discussions with people who want to know what's going on in other states and other school districts, especially suburban school districts similar to this one. And some of the items that I took out of an article in the New York Times about discussion, frankly, dissension between different points of view and Greenwich, Connecticut school system. I thought that was kind of interesting. One of the reasons I included it is that we have a state statute now, or it was a law from the legislature establishing a committee to work on outcomes. It is certainly something that's happening throughout the states for reasons that I'm not totally clear about. The term student outcomes has become a controversial one in some areas, and that article points out why. And it's actually controversial from two to almost entirely different points of view, which I think simply demonstrates how difficult it is for school boards to conduct public forums and get some kind of genuine consensus, because the same words will sound such very different meaning to different groups of people. I just thought that was interesting. Okay. That's it.
Well, thanks for providing us. It's always, you have access to more things than we do. You did include some other articles as well, and I find them very interesting for you. I'm sure we've all.
I'll look for some more cartoons.
The cartoons are good. Mm-hmm. The Calvin and Hobbes.
Oh, I love the Calvin and
Hobbes,
as you know.
The next item is superintendent's report, and first item is total quality meetings.
Yes, I did, and speaking of other items, I included three or four on this. I included two articles, or one is not really an article. One is a proposal to the school board. After summarizing some of the things that we've been doing this year, I have listed five recommendations. The principal one is, like the backing of the board in setting up a quality council with the following representation: school board 2, administrators 3, teachers 3, community services director who's been working directly on total quality issues, and three parents. The charge to this group would be to review the activities already undertaken and to make specific recommendations back to the board for future plans. I see this group as a steering committee to consider the possibilities for a strategic plan. And I basically listed sub-recommendations that flow from that. And I included an article. Did you all get that article?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Which gives you more of my own thinking on that. And I have tried to set a date, which we're going to try to meet in the afternoon so that it's not a lot of meetings. And I also think that this kind of group can set up a fairly clear agenda, fairly narrow focus, and 4 or 5 times between now and June. I don't see this as some kind of heavy burden, but I think it will be a helpful adjunct to the board to have that kind of group, and hopefully there'll be a couple of members of your group that will agree to meet.
Actually, Beth called me today and said she would be interested in it, and I certainly am interested in it, and I don't know if anybody else has any interest. I assume, obviously, school board members can come and sit in on meetings.
Of course, yeah. I mean, this kind of thing, there are likely to be people outside the specific parents or specific teachers, and I certainly would like to make sure that people feel welcome. But there does have to be a nucleus that will formally take this role of trying to make sense of all of this and what are the next steps and so on.
Is there some way we could publicize this so the parent community has an understanding of what's going on and might actually participate, or at least be looking to follow what we're doing with this? Is there a way to do that?
We could put it in parent forums, we could announce, you know, who the people are, please feel free to contact so-and-so. Frankly, I did, 2 years ago when we first started dealing with total quality, I had approached two of the people in the business sector in this community who had been helping us. One is Herb Brown, whom we have met, who came to one of our workshops last year, and the other is Pierre Stanieskin, who, both of whom are heavily involved in total quality operations in their businesses. And they very kindly told me a year ago that they would be willing to do this kind of thing, and I recently called them and said that we're ready to do that. Do you still have the time? And they said they could. Because I thought that would be one way, just as we're in the building committee, we have tried to include people, or the town council in their appointment process, tried to include people who have specific building construction background, as well as some people who do not. And that is helpful, as you can see, going through that process. That's why it's easy.
Okay, now you don't need to make a formal motion to do this.
If anybody had any questions, suggestions, or criticisms, or concerns, or whatever, let me know. Very good. And if you have a chance, a Howard Gardner article on learning for understanding. I rent out most of my Gardner books, and I don't know where they are at the moment, but when you come across a nice little article like this one, and I have to tell you that this was out of a magazine for superintendents, and like a lot of magazines where superintendents is written, I swear, on a fifth grade level. Having been a former English teacher and seeing the difference between the journal that gets published for English teachers and the journal that gets published for superintendents, I'm afraid there is a noticeable difference. However, in the hopes that this is written because people are busy.
Yeah, that's what I was
makes
thinking.
Makes a nice quick article.
Right before you don't want anything to be done.
Budget timeline. We have heard from the town manager, and you'll notice at the bottom of this timeline, a key date for us is March 30th, which is the time when we will be presenting our budget, along with the community services budget, to the town council. And on their timeline, they also had listed review of pending issues for April 5th, and I'm assuming that review of pending issues might include the school budget, so I put it on here too. With the public hearing and budget adoption slated for May 9th. If you will look at this timeline, I hope you've had a chance to do that for your own personal calendars. Hopefully this will work. Sarah?
I'm going to be away for 10 days in the middle of it, which is impossible. But that's fine. We leave Thursday, March 3rd, and come back Sunday the 13th. But plow forth without me.
Do I just attach or something?
Well since she mentioned that, maybe interrupt your superintendent's report.
Right.
I'm also going to be away March, probably 2nd through 10th. I've already spoken to Rosemary, and she's very graciously agreed to chair the Finance Committee in that process, and don't try to fax me anything.
I tried.
But my apologies after having sat here for, I think, 6 months and said, well, the finance committee's going to begin work soon on the budget.
Well, the good news is everyone gets to see the high school budget.
That's
March
the first one, yes, that's right.
So Rick's first budget can be reviewed by the whole.
Well, I'm sure he'll be glad.
Well, we have a larger board now, and that's the reason, I think, one of the reasons we have it.
Yes, it's true.
It is true. Plus, Connie had mentioned during the finance committee meeting that she's meeting with the administrators next week and invited any of us to come if we wanted. I am going to be going to that, and I think, you know, we'll be providing feedback on the direction things are going and try to.
Yeah, I would too, if you could be aware of.
What it is our first shot at putting together the individual budgets, which business manager and I are going through this week with people. And we don't have the bottom line yet ourselves. By next Wednesday, we will have a bottom line. And, of course, we always go back over things and say, this is what we think the shape of it is, and this is, you know, this is where the reality checks come in, and what are we going to do about it, and so on. So I think that the board would be welcome to that.
That was 9 to 11.
And
is that what you said, 9
to 11? 9
to 11. Well, we think also, and this will sort of take the place of the finance committee report, this final comment on the budget line. We have the computer model up and running very well, I think so too, yes. That should be very helpful.
Yes, I think it will be, and the fact that we have some figures now that we didn't have before. We still don't have a firm subsidy figure, which is going to be a problem, but we will put together that by next Wednesday we'll have a little better idea of how difficult the position is going we're in, how many choices we're going to have, and so forth.
Okay. I just have one question. Connie, remember last year we discussed having each school have their own night? And I was just wondering about putting the middle school and community services together.
Well, we could do that, and sometimes we actually run out of time in the district-wide accounts that I put in with PONCO. We can certainly go over to March 17th, particularly if two members have missed the others, and there would be no need for having that one. Community services really doesn't take too long, but on the other hand, that may be something that, for whatever reason, you want to. I tried to put two fairly short accounts in with the schools because they certainly do deserve and do take the full time.
Well, I guess the only thing I'd offer is where community service is very specific, and mm-hmm. Sue is able to provide us with concrete information. Could we at least shift it so she's first and so we know when it will end, whereas with the middle school, we tend to go for an extended period of time.
Sure, if you have a specific request, why don't I talk to Sue and Nancy, and let's see, the other one is a PONCO, a district counselor.
I don't have a problem with that, but I was thinking more of community services as a department. I mean, the superintendents and the district-wide accounts are generally without a lot of discussion. I just thought if community service were to go from 7:30 till 8:30, for example, the middle school would know, come at 8:30 and, you know, you can start that.
Well, let me do this. I haven't reviewed the community service budget. I'd like a chance to do that and see about, you know, what is the time frame that's needed. And I think what you're asking is that we have high school, middle school, and PONCO have the lion's share of the attention on that night. And that was our intention anyway. Okay. So we'll make sure that that happens. Anything else on that? Moving on. Wayne did intend to come in and discuss this with you and invite, again, speaking of inviting the board, to these various sessions on the exceptionality course. He did, in fact, come in this afternoon without power, without electricity, without everything, same thing, without heat in his house, and I told him I thought probably he should go home, and I would offer the invitation to you. I have taken this course, although some of the people teaching it, a couple of changes been made since I myself took it, but the, our own staff for the most part doing this, it's really a wonderful opportunity for you to learn something about not only the special education laws or various aspects of courses, but also to get to know some of our staff. They're really quite impressive with the way they discuss the program, their background knowledge, and I think they also do a nice job of involving people in kind of hands-on things. I would point out, oh, we were supposed to have one today. I guess we didn't, did we? Okay. Eric Herland is a member of our attorney's team who is an expert in special ed law. I would, do you know if that's been rescheduled?
Next week.
I mean, they're just pushing everything back a week? Okay. I would strongly urge any of you who are looking for an overview of special ed law. He is well worth hearing. He does donate his time, by the way, as a member of our the firm that we do business with, and he is a real expert, so you would get quite a lot out of that one. I also would point to the one listed for March 1st on gifted and talented, Jim Curry, who is a professor at USM, a kind of specialist in differentiated curriculum, which basically he looks at as going across the spectrum, not just gifted and talented. He also looks at this from a variety of points of view, but it is, he does in fact teach courses that are geared for gifted and talented. He's, an, I really think, a strong future resource for us because I'm aware of his work and aware of some of what's done with some other school districts. This is an issue that we have a lot of need to help people understand, help staff understand some of the ways in which other schools have worked that through, as well as reach out to parents and help them understand, as well as look at the way we organize things. We, differentiated curriculum is not just a matter of having different books for different folks. It's a matter of how we organize and use resources and so forth. And it's an issue that I hear in a lot of ways cropping up really right through the system. So I would also tag that one for you. And frankly, I don't want to overlook anything here. I must admit, when I heard Susie Safer talking about speech and language disabilities, I really learned a lot. I had no idea that there was such a body of theoretical knowledge behind that. And I'm sure Deb, I didn't want to hear Deb Casey speak, but I'm sure she's very knowledgeable too. So I think you would enjoy it, and I would urge you to come. And I'm trying to extend the invitation in Wayne's name as well as in the name of the entire staff.
Are there any course materials that go along with this that would make good reading for board members if they can't?
There are. Do they pass them out in advance or at the time?
No, pass them out in advance. We'd be happy to share some.
Okay, that might be helpful. I mean, I'm not sure everybody has to get everything.
It can be a lot.
Could,
I
yeah,
know,
sure
I have quite a
But maybe if there was even just a copy of it available and people could look through it and see what they might be interested in.
In my office.
Okay.
And there's one from the previous years that it's been offered to, so you can see.
That might be helpful if people can't comment.
Great. And Sue is really, Sue Coffey is the key person there because she runs the materials for that course, and it does get to be somewhat overwhelming at times. This course, by the way, is a service that the department, the school runs. We give a small stipend to the staff members. As I said, Eric donates his time as a member of a firm that works with us. And so it's a very cost-effective way for us to offer people a course that has been required for recertification within the last 5 years. And many of us have taken it for that reason. And I think, unless you have more questions. Moving on, it occurs to me that maybe as a board, individually possibly, you've never been through an accreditation process. Is that true?
Not as a board. Some of us through other institutions.
Not through the high school accreditation.
Not
well,
I've been here that long.
That's you know, this is sort of, we were talking about that, realizing, wait a minute, these folks don't know. In a very quick nutshell, school state law, and obviously in a community like this, we want to make sure a high school is accredited. The agency in New England for accrediting high schools, for the most part, is the NESAC agency. The process is teachers, administrators who work at the high school level on a yearly basis or two or three yearly basis sign up to be visiting staff. They come together in a group. How many are actually?
14 will be visiting here.
Representing all the major kinds of divisions in high school program. We have been preparing, the staff here has been preparing a very extensive booklet, self-analysis, takes quite a long time to do it. The idea is to get people to think through their programs and then to have a visiting team come in, read that material, but also come and visit classes and speak directly with the teams that put together each booklet. There'll be subject matter reviews as well as organizational reviews as well as building facility reviews. And there will be, as this little announcement here pointed out to you, a meeting with me as the superintendent, also with, of course, the building administration. And at the end of this, we get a report, and it usually is this big R requirement, which may not be too heavy in this particular case because the school does meet most of the criteria, but you never know for sure until you go through the process. And then the usual recommendations. It used to be 10 years, but lately it's been going more and more to 5. Have you had any discussion with anybody on that?
No, simply that it was 10 years before.
Right. But in the last several years, it's been kind of a trend to accredit for a 5-year period, then kind of not as intensive a process after that, but a sort of review in another 5 years and so on. So I think you'll find it interesting. It doesn't, at this point, require an awful lot of the board, but we will certainly be interested in moving people and understanding what the process. That material is all available here for review if any member of the board
through Sharon Merrill or Barbara Cummings has been one of the key people in that as far as organizing it and contact. I have pretty much daily, weekly contact with representatives from NESAC, and they forward me information. To reiterate on what Connie mentioned, there are basically two components to the reevaluation or evaluation. One is the learning areas, which we did last year as a faculty looking at each department. Now we're compiling what they call the standards for accreditation. And there are 8 parts to that: curriculum instruction, student services, administration, educational media services, school facilities, and assessment for educational progress, school climate, and community support and involvement. Of those 8, all but school climate and community support and involvement have been presented to our faculty and voted on in past. The school climate involves surveys that have been sent out there, I believe, a number of surveys that were sent to parents in the community, and also students that have also filled out surveys. We've compiled that, but it has not been discussed with our faculty and voted on. So those two areas need to be voted on, and then that's what we will present in March when the visiting committee comes. We had a meeting scheduled for today with, there were 5 schools, including KPOR, being accredited. And we were supposed to have a 10 o'clock meeting today to go over the format, and we had to postpone that. So I'll let you know when that's rescheduled. But we had people coming from various parts of the state. And I'll also pass this along to you. This is simply the, this was forwarded to me, various areas that will be, you can just pass those along.
Sure.
There are, of the 14 representatives, each of the areas that will be looked reviewed by the committees. So,
our meeting with the visiting committee, can you explain what or expound on that? In Sharon's letter, the visiting committee will want to meet with the school board for an hour Sunday, March 13th, from 4:30 to 5:30. Can you explain what our role in that?
Yeah, Charlie, I think primarily it's part of that meeting with you, having questions and concerns that you may have, and an opportunity for you for feedback with the school board. I'm not specific on that. Sharon and would have more information concerning specifics along the lines of the school board's involvement.
We'll ask for some kind of review of that. Sometimes that tends to be almost a social issue. People just kind of, you know, chatting informally. It could be more formal than that, but it's not likely that it will be, because they will be asking more formal questions in other meetings. Why don't we ask for a little rundown on people's experience on that so that the board members feel comfortable with it.
And February 1st, just for your information, Don Sturgeon, who is the principal of Old Town High School, who will be chairing The visitation committee will be meeting with myself and the faculty on February 1st. He also was the chairperson 10 years ago when the high school was accredited, so it'd be interesting to have some comparisons and see where the similarities lie in the recommendations and follow through 10 years later, so we'll see.
And I did include in your packet, simply letting you know that we have, after really considerable time trying to find an appropriate way, managed to deal with both the need for a high school extra section of Spanish as well as replacing a middle school position. Both of those are in the nature of long-term subs. They're not permanent appointments, and I did give you some information in your packet which satisfied that we have solved that problem. It does, however, illustrate a serious, I don't hope it's not a growing problem, in finding appropriate candidates for foreign language. And although we did, we had a fairly good pool, I think, this past spring when we were looking for a high school teacher, at that time we actually looked at the pool to see what there was for possibility for FLESS for the elementary program. We found that although there were certainly qualified people there, they weren't particularly interested in that grade level, and that wasn't their interest nor their preparation or their background. We have been, I think, extraordinarily fortunate in the quality and enthusiasm and appropriateness of the teachers who are dealing at those grade levels. So it's more of a specialty, I think, perhaps, than we realize. Anyway, we're all right for now, and we will be going back out in the spring for a that is the best time to get a full pool of candidates for a school position that will be working with us.
Item is school board subcommittees and reports, and the first is the finance subcommittee. Now, Peter, I thought I heard you say you'd already given your report.
I think I have. Maybe I should entertain questions first.
But on the budget issues? Or?
On any issue. I mean, I think we really covered the budget. We had our regular meeting, I would say, for the record, went over a number of issues just before this meeting. We always do that before every school board meeting. And I think the issue of how we're going to handle the budget is going to be dealt with, and I'll begin. Rosemary has graciously volunteered to cover those days. So.
Okay. Any questions of Peter? Okay, moving on to the policy subcommittee. Rosemary?
The policy subcommittee met on January 5th, last month, and for anyone who'd like to come, we'll be meeting again on the 9th of February from 9 until 11 o'clock in the morning, and it is a public meeting. But at that meeting, we had an extended discussion regarding a first reading of a policy that will be coming up under new business. We also went through Section J pretty well, and if I may just give the title of the policies and what we did as a proposed action so people will know where we are if they have any questions. The student withdrawal from school, we refer to the high school administration for review and recommendation. The policy on early dismissal of high school seniors, which is an existing policy, we also refer to the high school administration for review. Regarding students' rights and responsibility, which was suggested new language, we refer to the administrators for review and recommendation. The administrative guideline on the non-return of school property, which is an existing guideline, we refer to building administrators for review and recommendations. The existing policy on student conduct on school buses was referred back to Scott Poulin and Sue Weatherby. The administrative guideline on bus behavior, which is an existing guideline, was referred back to Scott Poulin and Sue Weatherby. The policy on hazing was referred to the high school administration. The existing policy on non-smoking by students was the action was to reaffirm. So my understanding is the board has to take no action?
Actually, I was just, yeah.
I have a concern of duplication.
Well, okay.
I think that okay, let's go through this and get sort of that through. As far as this one, the next one, and the one following, each of those actions and each of the policies is really different. So the reaffirming is, I understood it was because it's simply a kind of category of the general policy which holds true that there is no smoking at any time at any place, or this is our policy that there be no smoking by adult students or employees in period. Why that one is listed separately for students, I'm not sure. I think historically it may be that at one point, in fact I do know for a fact, that there was a smoking area for students here in the 70s. At some point that must have been a policy that was written to allow that, and that at some point perhaps the board rewrote the policy to make it consistent with the overall policy. If you're satisfied that your basic policy, which is no smoking at any time by anybody, does it, which in my opinion it does, we simply drop this one.
Okay. Any the students drop and the student drug abuse policy, we ask for a reaffirm. And on the confidential assistance program, we ask for a drop since the provisions outlined are incorporated in other policies and in the high school handbook. And that's what we did last month.
Any comments or questions? I have one comment, and this just reminds me that back from my days chairing this subcommittee, we refer out lots and lots of policies, and I don't know if they ever come back.
Well,
please will.
I mean,
please will.
The first one here is, in fact, one I had a feeling I was going to get that comment. I look back, the student policy here, which is now called the Community School Resources, is, in fact, a one we referred out in September, so that's coming back. And what I'm asking the high school to do is to take these as a group, and I'm not sure if you perceived me, but I know that my office has a packet to, maybe you and I can talk about this. Some of these are simply a matter of bringing up to date. Some of them are a matter of a recommendation that this is no longer needed, or this is a policy that we feel is covered by some other thing, and we will get back to you on that. On the school bus one, we have in fact changed the guidelines since these were, and it's just a matter of getting the update back to you. We will do that.
Okay, I think just, well, it may be kind of late in the process now since we're almost through the book, mm-hmm. but I don't know if all those policies we referred out in the last couple years have actually come back, and we're just waiting for the cycle to come around. But maybe when we refer things out, or when we are supposed to look at something, we should give ourselves some time to do it.
Good point.
So,
do you want me to say we'd like these back by March? Do you have to say that?
Well, what would be good for your
March. Or April. Rick, you got most of them. As soon as possible.
I'm sorry, your policies happen to be the ones that I noticed that we have a lot of outstanding policies. I'm not trying to pick on you. The next item is unfinished business and timeline for reviewing interim high school principal and vice principal assignments.
School building.
Oh, geez, I skipped a big one. Sorry. Okay, school building committee. Connie, maybe you should kind of give a rundown of the various meetings that we've been through, the zoning board, the abutters.
Okay. Since the last board meeting, which we've been before Christmas, we invited the abutters of the property to meet with us. We met with them twice. The intent was to hear their concerns and ask the architects to try to make adjustments that would take those concerns into consideration. We have finished that process at this point. We have met with the zoning board, which has, for the most part, addressed most of that process. There are, however, some unfinished businesses, mostly traffic issues. We have to go back in order to finish that. There has been one workshop with the planning board, which was an opportunity for the architects and whoever was there from the building committee to get a feel for what some of the issues that need to be addressed in the formal submission of the planning board. We have had, I think, three meetings of the building committee itself since that time. And one of them, although all of our building committee meetings are, as all of our, these meetings are public meetings, we did make the one last week on the 13th a unique effort to advertise it and invite people in, and some citizens did take advantage of that. And we tried to review where we were. In the process that's been going on now, there's this whole timeline of formal permitting. There is a survey going on, both topographical, line boundary surveys, various kinds of geotech surveys, these kinds of things that fortunately we had a pretty good December, and I believe all of the technical aspects are done. The surveys are not all written up, but they're all done. We've also had an update on the traffic survey. It feels like an awful time crunch here, and partly that is due to the fact that when the architects finished concept design last summer, we, of course, did not know whether we were going to be going forward with the project. In the best of all possible timelines, you would ask your architects to keep on going, and they would do all of these kinds of things in preparation for the final construction documents. We obviously had to wait until a referendum process, and so they have really been pushing hard to get those kinds of permitting type activities going and on, so we can stay on a rather tight timeline. In the meantime, there have been meetings with staff. There has been a lot of discussion about what the layout of classrooms would be. The building committee has been presented with some preliminary questions to at least consider things like the heating plant, which got to be a real crisis when we had our own problems here a couple weeks ago. I was wondering how soon we were going to get into that. And then the finishes, you know, what kind of, and most of those issues are not yet resolved. They're still being discussed, but I think that the, it's an example of how many decisions have to be made and the whole thing is moving along.
The footprint is pretty much concrete now as far as where classrooms are going to be, what the size they're going to be, and to some degree what they're going to be labeled. And there was a meeting also with administrators and interested building committee members. Both of your representatives and your alternate were at that meeting. So the board was well represented.
That meeting was particularly to make sure that there were the program spaces that we thought we had. And I think it was useful to kind of pin down. I would also caution that because we are taking the programs we have and translating them into a somewhat altered building, doesn't mean that those rooms are carbon concrete with that label on the door forever. It's a matter of, does the program as it exists now fit? And tomorrow, we have a meeting, asked to have a meeting with the engineer looking at the heating plant. With building administrators, I am concerned about getting a real handle on what next year is going to look like. The current problems that we are having with our heating plant, particularly as it crops up at Fontaine, simply emphasize the difficulty. I should report that it had a series of failures, some of them variety of circumstances. The most serious one was a very, very strong leak in the steam pipe that takes the heat from, or the hot water, the steam system underneath, from the boilers at the middle school, underneath the parking lot and into Pond Cove, and we were having a pretty serious leak there, which fortunately they were able to find and fix, and that has made a big difference. We've also taken a lot of the controls on the heating univents at Pond Cove, which at least has kept all the rooms now are at least habitable. Unfortunately, some are too hot. It's just an example of the fact that we do need a thorough renovation. I think that touches on things.
Yes, it does, and we will be dealing with the proposal to move the bus parking later. Okay, now unfinished business. Timeline for reviewing interim high school principal and vice principal assignments.
Well, time has come when we need to revisit that. We had agreed last year, we had a committee that Peter Leslie chaired. And when the board appointed the interims, high school principal and assistant principal, we agreed that we would come back together at this time of the year and decide how we were going to do it. In my notes, I suggested that one fairly obvious step is to reconvene the committee, which we can do.
Thoughts on that? Okay, well then.
Yeah, I think we should reconvene.
Okay, I was just going to ask for a motion.
Then I move we reconvene it as it was previously constituted, provided all those people are willing to go to at least one more meeting.
With
there's only one exception in that you would need another student participant, since Jenny Higgins is unlikely to return.
And it may not be necessary at this point to formally include a student, although that would be something that we could. If you have a strong feeling on that, or,
I would suggest that.
Okay. I would recommend we just ask the SAC for a representative.
Okay.
Would that be appropriate way to do it?
How would we do that, sir?
Ask the SAC to recommend a student.
For a student substitute?
And the only other item is the parents' forum representative. She may be involved, but she's no longer president, the person who is there, which would get to my request to read correspondence is from the current president, and that may tell you what her position is very loudly, so there's no reason to even include a parent, but would you like me to read this?
If it's appropriate to read it, it's in a public session, as opposed to reading it in the committee, and I don't know what it says.
I don't think that's a problem.
Good.
And I read it. Can I just say, we have a motion. Can we second? And then you can read it.
Second.
Okay, now would you like to?
Okay, for discussion, since we're talking about the makeup of the committee. To the Cape Elizabeth School Board, dated January 18th, 1994, dear school board members, I am writing this letter in strong support of Rick DeFusco continuing as high school principal. As president of the Parents Forum, I've had the opportunities to work with Rick closely during the past year. I have been impressed with his sincere concern for students and their well-being, not only on a personal level, but more importantly, for their academic success. Rick also cares very strongly about the reputation of Cape Elizabeth High School and is committed to its continued growth and excellence in education. In addition, the level of respect he commands from students, faculty, and the community members alike is further evidence of his integrity and leadership qualities. In closing, I'm enthusiastically in support of Rick DeFusco being named principal of Cape Elizabeth High School, signed by Anita Deegan, president of the Parents Forum. So maybe there's one person you don't need on your committee. You have her endorsement there. And by the way, she asked me to read that, or she would have been here except she had snow.
Well, was the was Ann Kerner there ex officio as president of the Parents Forum last year? Was that how she joined our committee?
I don't honestly remember.
I don't either.
She was
a full member.
She was a full member, but I think the question perhaps was, why, was she chosen because she was the president, or?
By virtue of her office.
Yeah.
I believe that's what happened to you.
I think one of the, you know, this certainly is just a thought, not necessarily concrete, but my sense of this kind of situation, the people who were involved in discussing, interviewing different candidates and so on, perhaps should be the ones who come back together, because I think that was a basis of decision-making then, and my understanding of our commitment at this point was to take that basis and see what's happened and make a decision, a recommendation to the board based on that.
I think that's what my recollection is that we did decide that committee would go forward and review the situation. So I think should be the same people, and with the exception of the student, as you point out, so you'll see that a student comes to that meeting representing the SAC and the students in general, and I don't think it would be a very large commitment of anybody's time. It's a personal comment that you may strike from the record.
Well,
but I think considering the options, I think a student is very important.
I would like to speak at this point as a superintendent, and just to say that, and this does not prejudice the process in the sense of a committee coming together and so on, but I think it would be really important for me to note that I have been very impressed and pleased with the way this arrangement has worked, and I think it is, I really think that we would be good for it.
I would just reiterate as board chair that
and as a parent, I will second that.
I need my word. Me too. And there'll be no problem getting a student volunteer. I've heard from many.
Good.
Okay, now we need to actually go.
We'll see that that Connie coordinates the dates.
Would you,
I'll
before
give you,
you
my
leave,
calendar.
Give me a couple of
dates. You one. Want Connie to
know? Okay. All in favor? Okay. New business. The first item is discussion and action regarding recommendation from building committee regarding moving the bus garage. And I think they did get Scott's memo, but I guess only the building committee members got this memo.
I thought of that just about the time I walked in here, and it's sitting on my desk.
I passed mine.
Did you pass yours down?
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Rosemary has looked at this, but
Carla might
be okay. Peter, you might want to take a look at that and disregard my notes at the bottom. They don't pertain.
All right. The bus garage. Basically, there are two issues here. Number one, we must park the buses somewhere. We can't just leave them where they are, because the space with the bus garage, as well as the part of the pavement that the buses typically spend the day on, will all be part of the new parking lot, exit pattern, and so forth for the renovated building. So they must move. The committee is outlined there, principally myself, Scott as business manager, Sir Weatherby, who works a lot, of course, with transportation, the town manager, the public works director, as well as the town mechanic who works on the buses, all got together. We, as the memo points out, we listed town-owned property where we could put the buses, and listed some criteria that would guide the decision about where we can put the buses, where's the best place to put them. And frankly, the only spot that meets all of that criteria is the student parking lot, part of which has been taken for parking for the municipal employees working at the Public Works Garage. That's the parking lot I'm talking about, the one that's right behind the IGA. At the time when the municipal parking changes, or the municipal traffic patterns were changed, and Jordan Way was closed off to through traffic and so forth, part of the traffic survey that the municipal people did, as well as some informal just going down there and counting student cars, made it clear that that parking lot in normal business is not full, and furthermore, that the number of cars that are parked there during our regular school day could easily be accommodated in the lower parking lot. It is not an issue for staff parking. Staff parking is accommodated in the parking lots that are here at the front of the building. The only issue is student parking, and then, of course, when we have things like soccer games or events where there's a lot of public, additional public parking. This is a process as far as testing out the number of slots and discussing parking is all part of the site review. We've already discussed that to some degree at the zoning meeting, zoning board meeting, but there'll be continued ongoing discussion of parking and traffic pattern through the planning board process. We are satisfied that there is room for student parking to the extent that is certainly available or used now in the back parking lot. We feel also that the plan for parking as submitted with the renovation adds 50 parking slots to the existing parking slots now. Admittedly, those 50 that are being added will be used primarily by people in the middle school, you know, staff and Pond Cove and people visiting that building. On the other hand, those parking slots would be available for certainly fall and spring weekend sports events. People can certainly walk down to the fields as well as walk up to the fields. And so we think as part of the general review, those pieces need to be noted. That's all one set of issues. Where do we actually park the buses? If they are parked outside, it does require us to add what I know is parking blocks, because in cold weather you have to have some way of preheating the buses, the game started and so on. Most school departments, frankly, don't have bus garages, and buses are stored outside. It is an issue in cleaning off the snow and the ice and so on. Certainly, the mechanic recommends strongly that we consider some kind of shelter for these buses in order to keep the winter wear and tear as minimal as possible. But at any rate, where they're parked, there is no other equally suitable space. The second piece of the bus garage dilemma is, what do we do with the bus garage? There has been a request, frankly, from our mechanic, as well as others who are familiar with the, to try to salvage some or part of the bus garage. And after considerable discussion, we recommend that the board authorize the superintendent to go ahead and ask for requests for proposals from contract groups to see if anybody can come in there and give us a reasonable cost analysis of what could be done with the garage. Some people are saying that you have a structure, steel structure inside that could be moved. Some other kind of shell could be constructed. Some parts of it could be used. As the proposal that the building committee saw last week, kind of a rough proposal to show you where the buses could be parked, there is a structure there about the size of a two-car garage. There are some items that do need to be stored handy to the buses. Tires, for one thing, are being stored now in the bus garage. There are other things being stored, but when you boil it all down, space for tires is an issue. And there apparently is not sufficient space for bus tires in the municipal garage. But that's just we've had preliminary discussion on that. I wouldn't want to get too specific about that at this moment. There is some concern about not only the electrical outlets, but also some availability of water to wash buses. If you just wash them in this kind of weather, it's not a real good idea. If you want to use them anyway. So the idea that bus garage does get some heat from, it's not directly heated, but it gets the overflow heat from the boilers. We are not talking about a heated shelter here. But there, if you authorize the request for proposals, we will go forward and see what comes out of that process. At least it is a way to find out what are our options. That is a separate piece, however, from the decision at the board level to actually authorize the architects to go ahead and plan for bus parking in the block behind the IGA. Now, have I sufficiently managed to muddle those waters?
I just wanted to comment.
It sounds like we have two motions.
Well, I mean, the two issues, I may have also, just trying to get to the real.
But it is two, yeah. We need two motions, they're two separate subjects.
Yes, that's correct.
That's for starters.
Right.
I just wanted to comment that when we discussed moving the student parking down, we did discuss also making some parking places close to the pool and buildings, sort of reserved for people coming in to use the pool, elderly people, et cetera, so that we wouldn't let the students just go and park right next to the pool and, you know, I mean, there would be some accommodation made so that that would still work.
And I see that as an administrative procedure that the high school administration would.
Yeah, Charlie, I think we're going to have to rethink the way we allow students to bring cars to school. We'll have to determine the number of spaces that there actually are there, and then probably go with, which we've never had before, since I've been in the high school, but with parking stickers, and giving the first option to seniors and working back, and when spaces are, taken up by vehicles, then we'll have to have some sort of cutoff point at that point, and then a waiting list as kids go on. I'm intrigued by the survey that was made, because there are certain days when that student parking lot is really full. It really is packed, so And things like election days and things of that nature, when that lower parking lot has a great amount of use, we'll have to make some sort of stipulations for those days too. They only happen three or four times a school year, but it does have a tremendous impact on the building and community services as well in that activity. So we'll have to really study that and have some kids involved in that decision too, or at least looking at the issue. But I think you're absolutely right. We really have to rethink how we've allowed kids to use their vehicles on, at school before, and come up with a viable option for them.
And there is a little time to do that. Yes. This isn't going to happen very, very near future.
The parking garage may come down quite early, because they have to start putting in the road.
Oh, that's true.
Even though the D-wing is the last to come down, which is part of the parking area, as far as bringing in the bus traffic, all of that is going to happen before the building is complete.
Oh, right, before it's complete, but it's probably not going to be enough.
Not in the first year.
This is where we need some help to make sure we get this.
See what the timeline is.
It will be helpful to have and I'm sure the students probably will be motivated to help us figure out just exactly how many slots, and I think it does raise an issue that many schools deal with. Many places have far more limited parking given the number of students than we do. And one of the things that I think we need to be prepared to do is to think through different scenarios, like voting day and so on, and how are we going to handle it? Because there should be some available parking at the middle school the middle school Poncove lot, when it's finally finished. This is not, however, going to be immediately available to us. And we've had some discussion whether 200 slots there are sufficient. We have 147 right now, so that's 50 in addition to what we have. We don't have enough right now. I mean, there are times when there are overflow kinds of situations, but 50 on top of what we have would be very generous for our problem. I mean, that would more than take care of what we normally see for traffic patterns. So I think, again, I'm hearing from various discussions over the years on this, we need to look at parking as a campus issue. This project is definitely reinforcing in a lot of ways that we are one campus. I mean, every permit we're putting out calls this a school campus. And so it is important to have that kind of input to make sure that we aren't overlooking something. But from the standpoint of where we put the buses, this is the only logical space that we have that is anything like available to the needs that we've seen.
And I think Beth's point's well taken. I mean, the amount of people that use the pool facility at various times during the morning, there have to be spaces available. Also, Lifeline and other programs. It's as they are leaving, students are arriving. There's an overlap of time there where spaces are crucial, especially for some, also for faculty. And Community Services has been very accommodating to ask their people to, you know, park in the upper lot so as teachers arrive and school personnel, that they can get close to, you know, as close to the building as they can, you know, be it weather permitting or whatever. So we really are going to have to study that.
One of the ADA concerns, too, is the accessibility of the tennis courts, and that is something that also might be addressed as an access from the middle school, which would give us another walkway to the high school.
And one thing, just on the voting, maybe this would be a good time, once that building is built, to move the voting up to the middle school and the elementary school. I'm sure you like that, probably had enough of it. But I also think it's good for the kids to see what's going on.
That's an interesting point. But that's that kind of thing. Where are the pressures going to come from? At soccer games or whatever? I understand that they would like to have from us some kind of a plan about how we're going to cooperate with the police and the public works and how we would mark off things and so on. And I think you had a conversation?
Yes, Dennis Judd.
Yeah.
And I walked the campuses last week, and we looked at alternatives for parking. And there are several that would be fairly cost-effective ways to put in some extra spaces. The area just above the lower soccer field, which is where cars park anyway, for access to the tennis courts and also to the lower soccer field. One of the concerns by the town is that, you know, they're constantly, you know, digging up the grass, parking there illegally. It might make sense to pave some of that area and have some extra area for student parking as well as for overflow for athletic events. And how, if it were an indoor event, accessing the gymnasium, you know, how they could access that doorway, which is now off where the kindergarten playground is. So if there was parking in that area, they would have access to the gym lobby. They'd also have access to the back of the pool area as well. So we looked at those kinds of alternatives.
Any other comments? Well, then I would entertain a motion first on the issue of taking that
It's entirely possible that part of the actual plan will allow some parking there, but I think it's wise at this point to realize that we may be saying that the entire space will become off-limits, but I'm not really sure about one idea.
On that sketch, wouldn't the 10 parking spaces referred to be like for bus drivers? So that's sort of all-inclusive. It is the whole parking lot.
Well, but there is, for the most part, room at the municipal employee end of that parking lot. There's a kind of a little barrier there that was part of that move. And there may be times when that's full. I personally have never seen that full. But at the same time, I mean, from a day-to-day point of view, we may have to rethink the entire parking lot.
My concern would be we've had a problem with the mixing of buses and cars, and this is our way to both isolate the buses of where they park and also to how they enter and leave the school. So I think trying to mix student population into that area is asking. It's not easy.
Could well be.
I move that we accept the building committee's recommendation regarding moving the bus garage. Moving the bus parking, excuse me. Second.
Any discussion?
I just have to say, I really hope we can find alternative parking, because we have 35 more kids coming into this high school next year than are leaving, which means in spring of 96, we have the potential for 30 to 35 additional vehicles. The fire chief has taken the parking spaces close to the building already, and if anyone doesn't come here during the day, they have no idea. And I think that Sue's parking loop over there is critical, and I've read reports from the municipal side that say that there is encroaching cars on lawns and that has caused a problem, and I think we need to find either dirt or asphalt for vehicles to be legally parked, because the police are also ticketing illegally parked cars, And if we want these to be community buildings, and if we want people to come to our games, and we want the competing teams to come, and if we want our students to park legally, then I think it's our responsibility to provide them a legal place to park. And then we'll vote yes.
Well, you make a good point, but we've been fighting on the building committee the impulse to just blanket the entire campus with asphalt, so there's a place for every car in Cape Elizabeth. And I think Rick's notion is a good one. If we have to get to the point where we have to permit student parking, I know that was done even at my high school, which had acres of empty parking spaces just because they thought on principle that, you know, kids shouldn't necessarily have a God-given right to drive to school every day.
Well, I agree with all of that.
And I don't think this is just an issue of the high school. The building committee has been wrestling with this concern about parents who bring and pick up their children, even at the elementary and middle school. And why do we have buses if we have to constantly supply the parking spaces for people to come and to bring and pick up their children?
Well, the state law does not require us to provide busing at the high school level. And in fact, if you look at the buses, they're pretty sparsely used. And I suppose at some point the board could go policy level, look at that. I suppose we just cut back on the bus service and use that money to create another parking lot. I mean, it's that's why this is really a discussion that needs to come to the board, because there is you really don't have an option with elementary, and in fact our elementary buses are used. I mean, state law pretty much requires us to have transportation. Even though we're a small town, we're too big to fit into the 1 mile parameter that you might have otherwise. So there's no question that we have to have some buses, and they are well used, even if they're also supplemented by private transportation. High school's a different story. You might want to think about that.
Yeah, just for the record, you know, we have been talking a little bit about talking to the administration ways of cutting down on the number of parents picking up all the time. I think there are some things that could be done administratively, perhaps. For instance, letting kids take another bus on certain days or whatever. There's a lot of picking up just because a child is having a friend over kind of thing. Sue doesn't look too happy, but anyway, I think
we already discussed that policy.
Wouldn't that be awfully difficult to approach it from that angle? I mean, it's such an issue of personal liberty to drive up to a public building and pick up your child.
No, but if the reason, there used to be a policy where your kid could go home on another bus. You know, if they were going to a friend's house,
that's a fair point.
But I think it's certainly
I don't know anything about this subject, Sue. I'm just making conversation.
There are difficulties.
Of course, there are difficulties, but there are perhaps ways of looking at why we have such an overwhelming number of people picking up their kids when there are buses available. So
I guess
we just need to look at that.
This is a good example of the devil is in the details.
In approving this motion, we would also be dislocating the student parking area. So somehow we have to instruct the administration to come up with some kind of alternative. I mean, if we just make this motion, we're going to put the buses in there, and we have an address.
Do we have to amend the motion to...
We're displacing what's being used as student parking. That's my concern. I'm thinking from a community aspect that what's going to go into the public record is we approved moving the buses there, say nothing of what we're going to do with the student population.
Well, I think that because of the permitting process and the kind of direction and authorization that the building, the architects need, I think you have to make a decision that says, having looked at the options presented so far, that you are accepting the recommendation as presented to move the parking, I mean, moving buses to that particular lot. Now, I think in a separate motion,
No, I agree. I don't want this lost, that's all. Because that, because what the public's gonna pick up is that we're displacing the student parking.
I understand. Certainly, the planning board's gonna ask about that. My concern is that if you hedge that now with, can the administration come back with a recommendation about, well, it's really not an administrative
No, I would make that a recommendation.
Issue. It's a building committee, and the planning board is, from what I can see of this process right now, the planning, I mean, the building committee will be asked to come up with specifics through the architectural landscape architecture, through the submission to the planning board, that we understand that there's going to be disruption, and what are our recommendations for dealing with that disruption. My concern is that if the board, if you pass a motion right now on this issue to accept it contingent upon our finding of it.
No, I'm not saying contingent. I'm saying we need to set some direction that the administration needs to start looking at alternatives.
I guess my concern is it's not really the administration, it's a building committee issue. I think what you would be asking is for the administration to be a part of that process to advise the building committee as to the extent of the problem as they see it.
Okay.
And to offer further recommendations for accommodating the displacement of the current traffic patterns and parking patterns. I think that's what you're asking.
That's what I'm asking. Yeah. The only reason I'm trying to make this clear up front. In fact,
yes.
You remember 2 years ago when the town asked us to give them some of our parking space,
right,
and also to change the direction, the traffic direction between the schools. I can remember a parent and a citizen getting up and saying, have you thought this out long term, because you know you're setting a certain precedent, and it turns out 2 years later we're now again looking at this whole situation.
Well, I think that is a concern of the planning board, will be a concern of the planning board, in the sense that the schools must look at this as a campus problem. And the campus problem is traffic, pattern of traffic, and parking, and the degree to which parking at one site on that campus may help alleviate overflow parking at another part, and how do we intend to use that? I mean, there is some use of the parking relocation at the middle school, which will have some impact on sports events. It will not help student parking, unless for some reason or other it might be a couple of kids, but I don't see that as a particularly good. So some of the things we're trying, so anyway, I think what it boils down to is you're asking the administration to research this and report to the superintendent, or to the building committee, to the superintendent, further recommendations as to the impact of this decision.
Correct.
Sue, did you get that by any chance?
Well, at some point, Randy and I would like to meet with the committee and just see the whole scheme of things and give us a better, before we come up with recommendations, to know what's available, what's not available, and again, specific numbers of spaces that are on the campus, and then come back with a recommendation. I would love the opportunity to be part of that discussion and then report back to the committee. I know in one case with Keith Weatherby, as far as the fields and adjustments being made there, he ended up meeting with one of the architects or planners, and it was helpful for that input too. So we will, you know, supply all the input that we could.
Yeah, in this case, though, we've needed this vote first,
yeah,
before we can really start that process.
We will work with
it.
Yeah. One of the things we do is perhaps survey and find out how many cars are actually coming, how many students are driving.
That'd be great.
Yeah, because it's one thing for us to have these traffic studies and go through on a particular day, but that doesn't take into account a special program or voting, which is quite a headache. I
really think that with the student help, and I feel quite sure they'd be happy to give it to us, probably much more extensive data would give us a pattern. We could talk about the specifics of how to do that.
I mean, we've had numerous discussions on site. It's becoming the point that we would like to get on to the issues of the building itself. And I'm the one that pushed this particular vote back to the board, because I feel it is a board-level policy that impacts how we handle other areas of the site, and we are displacing a certain population, and I feel that's a board-level. So I agree.
Does anybody remember the motion?
Accept.
I move that we accept the building committee's recommendation regarding moving the bus parking.
Student parking.
Okay, let's second it.
But it's student parking, then. Bus parking to the student, to eliminate the student.
No, you're not eliminating.
No.
You're just moving it to that.
I'm sorry, I'm not.
To what is the existing student parking lot, or?
We're eliminating student parking.
We have space in the back.
The motion is just moving, giving the building committee direction to move the buses to that particular lot. What we need to, either in another motion, is to direct the administration to come up with alternatives or suggestions to the building committee of how they're going to handle it.
Yeah, I think that's to involve the high school administration and alternatives.
Because I don't want that to get lost.
Right.
That's what's going to, just like the site.
That would be the second motion.
I would make a second motion.
Second, let's vote on this.
All right.
All in favor? 7-0. Okay. Is there a second motion?
I would move that we instruct the administrators, particularly the high school, to do a study of existing parking and come back with recommendations to the superintendent and the building committee.
Any discussion?
Only that I think that would be implicit in the initial motion.
Wow.
I'm happy to appease the concept.
And I guess it needs to be done very quickly, unfortunately. I mean, I think, I don't know, it all goes into the whole plan.
Well, I think a lot of it, we know we have the space.
I think for the planning board.
For the basic needs.
To get us caught up in it, though. It's probably going to have to happen sooner.
Yeah, and I think this could happen for.
The other missing piece would be the community services use of that space.
They took into account how many cars frequent that parking lot from 6 to 7 in the morning and then 10:30 to 12 noon and so forth. That can be anywhere up to 30 or more spaces.
And I think that kind of specific data is important at this point because it, when you boil all this down, if we didn't take that particular place for the school, for the buses, we would have to buy other land. We would have to modify the land at the dump. What do we call that now?
Transfer station.
Excuse me. I mean, there would have to be some accommodation, and that's a cost factor. We also looked at the parking lot behind the municipal building, which is certainly not sufficiently large as it now exists to accommodate all the buses, so that would also be an expense factor. And we also put Fort Williams on the list because that is also municipally owned land and could certainly house buses, but it is wildly inappropriate in a sense it's not accessible to the mechanics or to the bus pump, or it certainly opened to vandalism. There are all kinds of reasons why putting the buses up at the transfer station or at Fort Williams, or even for that matter, behind the municipal building. All of those options require money. Now, what we're probably saying is that once we understand better what some of the needs are for parking around the high school, there may well be a recommendation for additional paved parking pieces which are available. It isn't as if there is no space over in here that would add another 20 slots or something of that nature. So we're really only making sure that we have the data to go back to the building committee to say, yes, we can squeeze this in, or we can drastically cut back on high school if that's what you think the actual fact of whatever the actual facts of the impact would be. It's all going to cost something, and what we need to find out is what is the most cost-effective plan, what are the options we have,
but moving those buses somewhere is going to cost us something, no matter what we do. And that's what we're struggling with, because we do not have a renovation budget that includes the bus garage. And it's only marginally including moving buses.
And providing some kind of a storage.
That's right. So we need to have a specific list of options, costs, and so on, in order to really do the job right.
And maybe when you're looking at what to do with that lot and what to do about student parking and such, we look at what other communities have done with, you know, tight.
I'll call some surrounding. I mean, Gorham was faced with that this year with their construction, and I can call some schools and find out.
Gorham doesn't have as high a percentage of kids.
That's true. That's true.
But I think we ought to look into that with the idea of, you know, not having a, you know, necessarily space for every child to drive to school.
So I think what we need to present, not only to the board, but to the planning committee and in for preparation for the building committee, for the planning board, we need to be real clear about what our data is, what are the options, these are the best things, and so on. I think that's what we need, is something that's kind of laid out. Okay.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor? Okay, we need yet a third motion.
On the RFP?
On the RFP to do something with the, look into doing something with the bus garage.
Move that we direct the superintendent to put out a RFP on moving the bus garage or any other options of what we can do with it.
Let's just say options for bus garage.
Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Just have to editorialize a little. It just always amazes me how long we can talk about parking. It happens at the building committee level. The next item is policy first reading. Rosemary, do you want to introduce your policy?
Yes, the new policy is file IICC, Cape Elizabeth School Department Volunteers. The Board of Education endorses cooperative efforts between the community and the school system. The board is committed to offering a rigorous, stimulating education of the highest possible quality. In fulfilling this mission, the board supports the utilization of community resources, including volunteers, in our schools to complement and supplement educational programs. Volunteers provide significant services to students by supplementing the work of paid professional and paraprofessional staff. They work under the supervision and at the request of a paid staff member. They are not substitutes for paid staff. Volunteers will conduct themselves in a professional manner and adhere to the volunteer guidelines, which are available in the office of each building principal. Volunteer services are coordinated by the Director of School Volunteer Services, a paid staff position, who, by the way, presented this to the policy subcommittee at a meeting that we had last month, and her rationales are all presented in the packet of material. We asked for comments.
I have one right up front specifying that it's a paid staff position. I don't think it should be in a policy.
Well, it was interesting.
Because it could become a volunteer position at some point.
It could, but at the same time, it isn't right now. And that was recommended by the process. Gail Schmader, in the packet somewhere, and I don't remember exactly where, reference to the group that she met with, and that was recommended. Now, to be honest with you, I'm not sure, and I don't think that there's anything in here that necessarily addresses that business of putting in the word paid. I believe it was part of the group. This was a meeting that was sponsored at the state level for volunteer coordinators in these different districts. And my understanding of that recommendation was because they felt it was sort of an affirmation of support from the board to note that it is a good position. if you feel that's inappropriate, obviously, that's your policy. But that was a reason. It was not any, I don't believe there was any anything other than recommendation from the state group running the policy workshop that if it is a paid position, it should be noted as.
But these were directors of school volunteers or people involved in the volunteer program, and it just kind of solidifies that it's a.
Well, do you feel that way?
I find that to be, I don't see that we have that in any other policy.
I think that it's a helpful descriptor of the intent of the board, and that is that we take the volunteer concept to be a significant part of our school system, and that we commit resources to it. So I would be in favor of continuing it with the policy as a statement of the intent of the board and how we would like to continue to approach the running of the school.
See, I see that as this particular board making that affirmation and locking in future boards.
They can always amend
the
policy.
That's what we do with every policy. We take this board's intent and try to design it to be continued down the road and some further board objects, and they have the option of reviewing the policy.
That's true, but I guess I do see Charlie's point that we don't specify that something's a paid position in any other policy, and why that would be particularly important in this policy seems like something that's more of interest to the director of school volunteer services than the board needing to make that happen. But
I think some of it was that there wasn't an effort made to state that the volunteers are responsible to follow guidelines, and that volunteers, although they are volunteering, they are reporting to people who are not volunteers, who are therefore capable and cognizant of the rules and regulations, policy, and administrative guidelines within the school system. And I think that weren't we trying to make very clear that although volunteers can change from week to week, job to job, duty to duty, day to day, that the consistency of the volunteer coordinator and the policies and guidelines of the schools continue. And I think that's why that emphasis was placed.
Would it work if you simply took out the first two paids and said volunteers provide significant services to students by supplementing the work of professional and paraprofessional staff? They work under the supervision and at the request of a staff member. They are not substitutes for paid staff.
I would have to ask, go back frankly to Gail, and ask a little more about the discussion that prompted the use of that. I mean, I think that Rosemary's statement is exactly what she was saying, but we didn't happen to spend a lot of time on that. We were working through other issues here. And I think it was our understanding, much as Marcus has stated it, that the intent was simply to recognize that it is something that the board wants to make work well. It doesn't want to necessarily create a whole new strand of something or other, but that in the spirit in which this is stated, to be in competition with staff or, certified staff, or maybe the word certified a couple of times, that didn't work for everything either. What we can do between now and next month is I can discuss with Gail and find out more about it, and if that makes it more acceptable, we could perhaps make that suggestion.
My other comment was, we're the school board, not the Board of Education. So we'll see this again next month anyway, but I do think it would be good to have a clarification about why to her that is particular.
I think it was because it was recommended that in that group for the reasons that have been stated. And I think, frankly, I would like to compliment Gail on spending a considerable amount of time working what it looks to be a very short policy, and the information that is in the packet that she brought back from the workshop on, in fact, I think she went to two as a follow-up workshop, on how to think about policy and how to generate policy, I thought was really helpful.
and the fact that Policy Subcommittee, looking at it, thought it was too, so we decided to include it for your recommendation.
Has this been run by council?
Would I, frankly, it's not that policy, I would see any reasons for it. Unless there's something specifically that I'm not thinking of. And I think they, I do think that this, frankly, there is a lot of meat to this policy, and the commitment behind it is one that we've talked about in other ways. If we are going to really make the significant breakthroughs in giving children the kind of individual attention that hopefully real, ongoing, thoughtful learning is going to require one teacher and even 20 children, is simply an impossibility in an individualistic society. So much of what goes on in classroom is classroom management, and we've already talked tonight about differentiated curriculum a little bit, just mentioning it. These are very, when we talk about parking, this is so much more substantive and so much more important for the real rethinking of how do we do it. How does even the most talented, sensitive, and caring teacher really hear little clues from small children about what they know and what they do not know? One person cannot do it all. And so the whole affirmation of the use of paraprofessional and volunteer is a direction in how we rethink how we can really do a better job, and that's why it's important to have a policy for people to understand it. I understand what you're saying about these sort of work, hey, if it's a problem, I'm sure we can work it through. But I think that I really was pleased with the way Gail had somehow stated that it was a board commitment that we wanted to make this work. I do know there are parents who are concerned about the use of volunteers and concerned about the use of teacher assistants for a variety of reasons. We feel we have a commitment to do training, to have guidelines, to have somebody who's responsible, to encourage teachers to think through. Those are really substantive issues, and I would want to support a policy like this and help find the right wording to make it.
I think it's a very, very good policy, I think, and it's, I think it does all the things that are apparently behind it, you know, but I think those words could be just taken out with, and the whole intent of the policy would still be there, and I think it's something that we've all, we agree with. And I would say that Gail has done a very good job of putting together guidelines, getting people in there, you know, who have been trained, you know, appropriately to work with the kids. So I think she's doing a real good job.
No, I would concur with Anne. I'm trying to undermine her, you know, her efforts, but I don't see this in any other policy where we designated a position as a paid position.
I will go back over.
Okay. Moving on to personnel requests. Our first is consideration of a request for a sabbatical leave for 1994-95.
We have a letter in your packet from Charlotte Hanna, who is currently teaching math at the middle school. And she is explaining her intent, and she did apply under the guidelines in our contract. We did have a meeting with her, and according again to the provisions in the contract, it is a recommendation of that group that her proposal is a worthy one. Just to summarize for the public, Charlotte is proposing to go back and expand her mathematical background. She has certainly proven herself as an able teacher. And in our discussion with her, I think she gave us many insights into how she would use this opportunity to further our program. She is already coordinating and advising our middle school math programs, and I would certainly support that.
Entertain a motion.
Hi. I served on the sabbatical plan as well. We have to make the motion that we grant the request for a sabbatical leave for 1994-95 for Charlotte.
Second that.
Any discussion?
in favor?
Beth, did you have your hand up?
Yes.
Okay, the next one is a request for a leave of absence for 1994-95.
And this is a letter from Betsy Wiley, high school, actually the chair of our high school community department, another outstanding member of our faculty who is looking to add to her own understanding of a variety of things. She wants to take the master's degree in New England Studies program through USM. She's already been involved in some preliminary coursework on that, and after giving a lot of thought, she was first thinking of doing it part-time and so on. She really feels that it would be important for her to have this leave of absence for the year to complete it.
I move that we grant the request of an unpaid leave of absence for 1994-95 for Betsy Wiley.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Okay, the next is appointment to Community Services Advisory Commission.
And this is actually Deborah Riley, who is already serving and is willing to serve another term. Is that included?
She fulfilled the remaining term of Donna Rubin, who moved out of district, so she is now applying for a regular first term.
And is that 3 years?
3 years.
3 years. And we simply included the material she had given us before because that was last year, and it's the same type of thing rather than ask her to fill out an amendment.
And entertain a motion.
Okay. I move that we confirm the appointment, or do we recommend the appointment to the county?
I'll confirm.
That we confirm the appointment of Deborah Riley for Community Service Advisory Commission.
Chris, second move.
Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Okay, the last thing we had on here was request to go into executive session, but we will not be having an executive session tonight. Further to report this time. I'm sure we'll be having one after our February meeting. So the public is aware, we do have some upcoming meetings. The school building committee will be meeting Thursday night, January 20th at 7 o'clock in the superintendent's conference room, and again Thursday, February 3rd at 7 o'clock in the superintendent's conference room. The policy subcommittee, Wednesday, February 9th from 9 to 11 in the superintendent's office, and the February school board meeting is Tuesday, February 8th in council chambers, preceded at 6:30 by the finance subcommittee.
I should amend the school building committee. We met last week in the cafeteria downstairs. It seemed to be really a nice spot. It was more room than we normally have. I believe that Connie has checked and that you can use that, so I would just alert you to that. As you come in for that meeting, there's a little bulletin board and we always have a sign on it, but I believe that has been changed to the cafeteria.
Can I ask just one question? Is the February school board meeting going to be the 8th? Because we moved the policy subcommittee to the 9th.
And that's why, you know, I'll try to complete the circuit on the volunteer discussion, since it seems to be so pointed on that issue. Perhaps that's something I can take and discuss with you rather than have the meeting, but give you some feedback on that. We did discuss that, and I know at that policy subcommittee meeting we talked about whether we would move it. Then Ann and I talked about moving the February meeting, and then we looked at our budget schedule and we looked at February vacation, and we thought we might as well have it.
Are we going to change? We're going to leave the policy subcommittee
right.
for February 9th?
Right. I mean, there's plenty to do, and that we won't get as, I think I can get hold of Gail and give you some feedback on that very specific point that was raised today. And maybe we'll have some feedback from the administrators. The stuff that we handed them.
Thanks.
Hopefully.
Okay.
They're being